Greetings. Thank you, brother, for your comment. You wrote, I say that 1 Kings 8, 41-43 is the Prophet Solomon, peace be upon him, talking about the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. I have to admit, your claim of mention of Muhammad in the scriptures in 1 Kings 8, 41-43 is entirely new to me. I'm actually excited at hearing something new from Islam that we can go examine. Well, let's look at what 1 Kings 8:41-43 says in context, because the Word of God is a coherent text and context matters. 1 Kings 8:22. Then Solomon stood before the altar of Yahweh in front of the whole assembly of Israel, spread out his hands toward heaven. The general context surrounding this is that Solomon is saying a prayer over the temple in Jerusalem. I have to point out, brother, that Prophet Solomon prayed standing, with his arms and hands up, spread out toward heaven. Then Solomon stood before the altar of Yahweh in front of the whole assembly of Israel, spread out his hands toward heaven, and said, Lord Yahweh, the God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven above or on earth below, you who keep your covenant of love with your servants who continue wholeheartedly in your way. Notice, brother, this is Solomon praying to Yahweh, the God of Israel, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You have kept your promise to your servant David, my father. With your mouth you have promised, and with your hand you have fulfilled it, as it is today. Now, Yahweh, the God of Israel, keep for your servant David, my father, the promises you made to him when you said, You shall never fail to have a successor to sit before me on the throne of Israel, if only your descendants are careful in all they do to walk before me faithfully, as you have done. And now, God of Israel, let your word that you promised your servant David, my father, come true. So this is still Solomon praying to God, putting God in remembrance of his word. But will God really dwell on earth? The heavens, even the highest heaven, cannot contain you. How much less this temple I have built? Yet give attention to your servant's prayer and his plea for mercy, Yahweh, my God. Hear the cry and the prayer that your servant is praying in your presence this day. May your eyes be opened toward this temple night and day, this place of which you said, My name shall be there, so that you will hear the prayer your servant prays toward this place. Hear the supplication of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray toward this place. Hear from heaven your dwelling place, and when you hear, forgive. This is still Solomon praying to God, making supplication on behalf of himself and Israel. When anyone wrongs their neighbor and is required to take an oath, and they come and swear the oath before your altar in this temple, then hear from heaven and act. Judge between your servants, condemning the guilty by bringing down on their heads what they have done, and vindicating the innocent by treating them in accordance with their innocence. When your people Israel have been defeated by an enemy because they have sinned against you, and when they turn back to you and give praise to your name, praying and making supplication to you in this temple, then hear from heaven and forgive the sin of your people Israel, and bring them back to the land you gave to their ancestors. When the heavens are shut up and there is no rain, because your people have sinned against you, and when they pray toward this place and give praise to your name, and turn from their sin because you have afflicted them, then hear from heaven and forgive the sin of your servants, your people Israel. Teach them the right way to live and send rain on the land you gave your people for an inheritance. This is still Solomon praying to God on behalf of Israel in various situations. When famine or plague comes to the land, or blight or mildew, locusts or grasshoppers, or when an enemy besieges them in any of their cities, when disaster or disease may come, and when a prayer or plea is made by anyone among your people Israel, being aware of the afflictions of their own hearts and spreading out their hands toward this temple, then hear from heaven, your dwelling place, forgive and act. Deal with everyone according to all they do, since you know their hearts, for you alone know every human heart, so that they will fear you all the time they live in the land you gave our ancestors. This whole context is Solomon praying for Israel, for Jews, for mercy and patience and forgiveness from God. In the next verse, Solomon will continue praying, but he no longer prays for his people, God's people, the children of Israel. As for the foreigner who does not belong to your people Israel, but has come from a distant land because of your name, some translations say stranger instead of foreigner. The point of Solomon's prayer is for non-Jewish people who have come to the temple having heard of Yahweh, because of your name. I'm sure some will want this phrase to mean because of God's reputation or a metaphorical meaning. If this were the only mention of God's name in this passage, that might be an issue. But God's name Yahweh is used all through this passage, and more than 5,600 times by the prophets. As for the foreigner, it is simply error, brother, to see the word foreigner and immediately imagine it means Mohammed. Perhaps because you think Mohammed is so important, you imagine the word the, as in the foreigner, must refer to a single individual. That too, brother, is an incorrect understanding of this verse, and the next verse presents the clear, correct understanding. For they will hear of your great name and your mighty hand and your outstretched arm when they come and pray toward this temple. Remember, brother, you try to imagine this refers to Muhammad. This is simply incorrect, brother, on every single point of the scripture. They is a plural term, so this means all the foreigners, multiple, many, who come to the temple in Jerusalem. Second, they come because they hear of God's great name. Muhammad never once demonstrated he knew the name of the God of Israel. At best, Muhammad repeated the claim there is one God, which is insufficient knowledge. But the name Allah was relatively, if not absolutely, unknown before Muhammad began his jihad across Arabia. But even claiming Muhammad elevated the name Allah to be feared, Islam does not direct a single person to the temple in Jerusalem. They come to Jerusalem to come to the temple in Jerusalem. Muhammad never once came to Jerusalem. The night journey is an invention. And Islam has no doubt tricked you with the claim of a night journey to Al-Aqsa by Muhammad. But that is an epic failure at deception, brother, because the temple Solomon spoke of did not exist when Muhammad lived. It had been destroyed hundreds of years before Muhammad was even born. For they will hear of your great name and your mighty hand and your outstretched arm when they come and pray toward this temple. No, brother, there is no rational way this could refer to Muhammad. Then hear from heaven, your dwelling place. Do whatever the foreigner asks of you, so that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your own people Israel, and may know that this house I have built bears your name. I'm pretty sure, brother, that you want to imagine this is Solomon telling Jews they should obey the foreigner. Do whatever the foreigner asks of you. This is probably the only phrase in this scripture you really consider important. Do whatever the foreigner asks of you. But this is Solomon still praying to Yahweh God. And Solomon even explains why he is requesting this of Yahweh God. So that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, Yahweh God. God, when strangers or foreigners or non-Jews come to the temple and pray, God, hear even their prayers and answer their prayers, so that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you. This is still Solomon praying, brother, praying that God would bring himself glory using the temple. Solomon is praying to God. I cannot make that any clearer, brother. Solomon is not telling Yahweh God to obey and submit to Mohammed in Islam. Your original claim, brother, is that 1 Kings 8:41-43 is Solomon mentioning Mohammed. I say 1 Kings 8:41-43 is the prophet Solomon, peace be upon him, talking about the prophet Mohammed, peace be upon him. Now that I have explained the context and the verses in painstaking detail, let's just read the passage without interruption. As for the foreigner who does not belong to your people, but has come from a distant land because of your name, for they will hear of your great name and your mighty hand and your outstretched arm. When they come and pray toward this temple, then hear from heaven your dwelling place. Do whatever the foreigner asks of you, so that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your own people Israel, and may know that this house I have built bears your name. Is it possible this refers specifically to Muhammad? No, brother, there is no chance in heaven or earth this refers to Muhammad. The only question, brother, is do you have any regard for the truth? Because the proven truth is that this is not mention of Muhammad. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.